I'm DJ Premier, and I present to you, So What's Up.
Okay, computer. Run it back.
So What's Up. 1991, we going to the West Coast. Been in the West Coast for a long time doing my thing. And, you know, so much history there. And we're talking about 1991. I go back to the LA side of things, which at that time in the era of hip hop, it was such an exciting moment just to be there and learn the experience from certified artists out there that have always shown us love on the West Coast. And, you know, from that point, they took us around the neighborhood. They took us to the, like, deep, dangerous areas just to grub out and just do things in the West Coast, see the lowriders, see Crenshaw, and again, 91. And to experience all of this, this is why we're doing this episode, because it's special, because I got a couple little things in the mix that I've worked on, and one of them, I'm not going to grab the dish yet because there's a lot of rewinding to do to bring you to the forefront. First of all, shout to Ice-T, the icon, the legend, because he's the first West Coast artist that I ever worked with on a record. It happened to be called Lifestyles of the Rich and Infamous. I did the remix, all right? And it was my first experience. It wasn't an original version. It was a remix. This is not the one that we're going to salute in regards to the episode that's going on right now. It goes a little bit deeper. But salute Ice-T. Ice-T is just, he's just that dude. Now, moving forward a little bit, here's the next contact of West Coast stuff that I got to be a part of. And this is how it starts. Gangstar, rest in peace to Guru. You're forever with us. Here's how it goes. 1989, Gangstar was still being managed by Patrick Moxie, who was the ultimate manager and label. He didn't even own Payday Records yet. This is the early stage. He was our manager at the time, and also another iconic artist had just joined our stable of the management team as an artist. And he's from the legendary Juice Crew. You know the Juice Crew if you know hip hop from the era of the greatest shit to ever come out. And he, one of the members, he goes by the name of Master Ace. Now dig this. Ace had just joined our management team as one of the artists that was me. Even Moby. Yeah, Moby. Y'all know, if you're music, you know Moby. Moby was also on our roster. So, Patrick says, I got a gig for you out in Anaheim in California. That's outside of LA. It's going towards Long Beach. But he said, I got a gig. Now, I don't know if there was a confusion because we were called Gangstar. And the gang shit was really heavy out there even then. Even though it goes back to the 70s, the Gangstar name may have tapped in to where the promoter put that into the mix. Whether they did or not, we were there to represent. Our only album out at the time was No More Mr. Nice Guy, but we was popping with Words I Manifest, and it definitely didn't blend with all the artists that was on the roster, but we blended in because we were already official doing what we do. Now, the roster was above the law, legends, icons, recipes to KMG, the illustrator, shout to GoMac, and shout to DJ Total Chaos, all right? We all go back like that, all right? Who else was on there? Low Profile, that's Dub C and DJ Aladdin, more icons. Rest in peace to Dub C's brother, DJ Crazy Tones. Woo, forever missing you, bro. And Coolio, another legend and icon, was not a solo artist yet. He was part of the group as a hype man. You know what I'm saying? Especially when Dub C and the Mad Circle started their crew, and then DJ Crazy Tones, which is Dub C's brother, I repeat again, became the new group, and Coolio was in that group and then expanded into being a solo artist. And you already know his catalog and history is just as massive. Shout to Coolio. And also another artist who we didn't even know, never heard of him or anything, but we got to know him. Me and Guru are walking into the venue to get ready, and we see a guy two guys. One's just regular hair, got on the hat, looking ill. He's known as the Chill. And the other guy looking ill too had a Jerry curl, dressed in black khakis. Probably had on, I think he had on some Cortez Nikes, all right? And he had two beepers on his hip. And Guru walks up to him and goes, "Yo, why you got two beepers on your hip?" He said, "Wants the business. My name's Eiht, not Eight, Eiht." Cause that's that West Coast swing. I love their accent. And that guy is Mc Eiht of the legendary and iconic group Compton's Most Wanted. Shout to DJ Mike T. Shout to DJ Slip, who was their producer. And shout to the label owner prior to, I gotta go back again, DJ Unknown. Now, before I bring the disc up to get to that point, I gotta explain the whole thing on how Compton's Most Wanted got to the point of getting to us. DJ Unknown was from Detroit, transplanted over to LA, started a label called Techno Hop Records. Now, you gotta understand, Ruthless was getting ready to build with Eazy-E and all of those classic records, but there was a label called Crew Cut Records, which had the world-class Wrecking Crew, where Dr. Dre, DJ Yella, got their start as far as being in a group, and let's not forget, the owner who owned the club, if you've seen Straight Outta Compton movie, you already know. Shout to Lonzo. Lonzo is how Compton's Most Wanted started to trickle up. They said they were just going along for the ride to a session that happened to be going on with Lonzo, and they just happened to be there. So with Lonzo being an owner of a club and also running a label with Crew Cut Records, and again, Eiht and the whole crew happened to tag along with another group of people that were there at Lonzo's session. DJ Slip and DJ Unknown happened to be there, all right? Now, you know what? I had to get my facts straight. I always like to have my facts straight. I called Mc Eiht. Let him explain this and then we'll move forward. Ring.
Unknown was already there and we met him when we was there. He heard the demo, liked it, and then put us with Slip. Lonzo was working on the Compton compilation. So when we met, it was decided that we would start working with Slip. And then our very first song, Rhymes Too Funky, they put on the Compton compilation. That song ended up on our very first album, through Orpheus, Rhymes Too Funky.
Got it.
So
okay.
That was our first song. Yeah.
Got it. Now, with that being said, first single comes out on Techno Hop Records. It was called This Is Compton, all right? From there, they got picked up by a label called Orpheus Records. In addition to that, Ice-T at the time was on that label. Six in the Morning is a classic, Dog in the Wax. King T was also on that label, and man, what a startup of just straight, raw, hard records that you could not front on from the West Coast. Now moving forward a little bit, once that level of releases started to take place and the buzz was already starting to grow, then here comes Orpheus Records, who was distributed by CEMA. That's C-E-M-A. That was also the home of EMI Records, also Chrysalis Records, SBK Records, and so forth. At the time, Gangstar had just gotten a deal with Chrysalis that coincided with the timing of Compton's Most Wanted getting picked up by Orpheus. So we were quote unquote label mates. This is how we found out, because when Guru talked to Eiht and he introduced himself, he said, "Yeah, I'm Eiht. Yeah, and we're label mates, by the way." And we're like, "We are?" He's like, "Gia." Since Gia is so iconic and known by everybody, all the peers that Mc Eiht's affiliated with, including all of us, we did a project back in 2017 called Which Way Is West, and the campaign was really dope. I'm very into creative and unique stuff, and I told Eiht, "Why don't we do a Gia campaign to promote the album and set it up, since you hadn't been out in a long time?" And he's like, "I'm with it." Well, he actually said Gia. So with that said, I reached out to every artist and everybody, from Dr. Dre to Kendrick Lamar to J. Cole to Queen Latifah, Khaled, Nas, Scarface. Everybody I called and said, "Could you do this drop for me in a video form to promote this album?" LL Cool J as well. They were like, "Yeah." They weren't like, "Do what?" They understood as soon as I said his name. That's how synonymous this thing is. So, let's continue. From there, as he said we were label mates, he said, man, matter of fact, before I do that, I got to show you a little piece of that promo we did, because it was so dope. Shout out to Ice Cube as well. Run that.
Gia, Mc Eiht.
Gia.
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 Which way is west?
Gia.
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 Which way is west?
Gia.
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 Which way is west, baby?
Gia.
Which way is west?
Gia.
Which way is west?
Gia.
Oh shit, Mc Eiht got a new joint coming.
Which way is west?
Gia.
So I guess I gotta go out, cause I ain't finished. I grow up to be a straight up menace. Gia.
Which way is west, man?
Are you dumb? MCA, which way is west?
Y'all know what it is, nigga.
You reppin' the hood, eh?
So from there, well, we go back to 1991. The show that we did was during the time Ice Cube had left NWA. This is before Death Row was officially up. Suge Knight was rolling with DOC at the time. This is how far back we go. I remember JJ Fad was there backstage. The backstage was full. MC Ren was there from NWA. I got to meet him. Everybody was just so cool and giving Gangstar their respect. And it was just a dope ass show. And at the end of the day, moving forward, I remember H said, yo, I got a new album coming out. It's called, it's a Compton thing, but we just shot a video called One Time Gaffled Him Up. He said, be on the lookout for it. And it was just so grimy because it took you to Compton and in the hood, and it was just a real, real raw video. Here's a little piece of that. Run the One Time Gaffled Him Up video right here. Okay, now, the second album happened to come out, and it was called Straight Checkin' 'Em. This was the sophomore album of Compton's Most Wanted's career, and with that, during this era of it, now we're all friends. We always stayed in contact with each other. This is before cell phones. This is just regular home phones, unless you had a car phone. Car phones were real popular back then before regular mobile phones. That's, again, how far we go back to the era of just living this hip-hop life. Now, fast forward to 1992, Orpheus gets picked up by Epic Records and they drop the third album, Music to Drive By. They're about to drop a single, and this single, they want an East Coast remix and a West Coast remix. The West Coast remix was provided by, of course, DJ Slip, but the East Coast remix was provided by me, and it was called Death Wish 2. I called it the Gangsta Lean remix. Notice that on this floppy disk, it does not say S950. It says S900. Now dig this, an S900 could not read an S950 disc, but an S950 disc could read an S900 disc. We were moving up into different sample times, so this shows you how far back we were before I got into the 950 era of it. So, and it was 85 beats per minute, you know, that slow drive and shit. So from there, they sent us the reel, which they had to mail to us because it was on 2-inch tape, and those reels weigh at least 10 pounds. Once it got to us, I threw it on and I just started tapping out a beat. And mind you, if you're late, you shouldn't be now, we're over 30 episodes in. The sounds that you always hear from this era of hip hop that I was producing are contained on these floppy discs, thinner than a waffle, you know what I'm saying, and a piece of bread. but it was on these. All this data stored on here. Then it is transferred to be played on the MPC-60 or the MPC-62, which is provided by the company Akai. All right. Now, with that said, also, in order for these pieces of equipment to communicate, it is joined by these wires that were speak the same language and connecting, called MIDI. Shout to Dave Smith, who just recently passed away, and he created the MIDI idea. Okay, and with that idea, that's how we synced up everything with the help of a box called the SBX80, made by Roland, another incredible company, and all those connected to the 2-inch tape machine is how everything moves at the start on the same time. Okay, so with that said, moving forward, I tapped the beat out, sent it out to Mc Eiht for approval. Now back then, didn't have email, had to send a CD pressing and FedEx it for approval, and a cassette, because CDs were new to us to make a song to get approval on. This is how far back we go. Once I sent it, Eiht said, yeah, it's a go. And I was like, all right, let's rock it. Now let's hear the version I did. And y'all know, when you insert this, even though it's an S900 disc, it is going into the S950 disc, because as I said, 950s can read 900s, 900s cannot read 950s. Insert this into the S950, and when you load it up, this is what you get.
Death Wish. 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 You better scatter quick, cause you know you can't hang. With the 8, get it straight, cause I'm dropping these gangsta things. Lock the doors, running hot. Can't nothing save you when 8 hot poop rides peak. I'm putting clowns to sleep, ready to put my work in on the fool whose talk is too cheap. You shouldn't have made that tape, but you pushed me. The brother with the perm, who's skinny as a worm.
There it is, y'all. Shout to Compton's Most Wanted. Shout to Mc Eiht. Shout to my man Chill. To my man Bam, hold your head. That's my dude. Shout to Bam, who's also CMW. And also shout to DJ Mike T. And also shout to DJ Slip and DJ Unknown. All icons, all legends, all certified. And that's what's up.
It's a death wish. Death wish.